Welcome to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. We have episode 2 in our series with HashiCorp Vault, where we welcome the guest, Rob Barnes, to the show. So tune in and learn more about HashiCorp Vault. Welcome to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. We're back again with another episode with my good friend and guest, Rob Barnes. Welcome back, Rob.
Hey, thanks for having me.
I'm glad to have you back. This is such a great topic. We're talking about zero trust security with Azure and HashiCorp Vault. So last time we talked about automating the creation of accounts with Active Directory into Vault. This time we're going to talk about the secrets engine. So Rob, take us away.
Brilliant. Yeah. So as April said, what we were talking about last time is managing our identity centrally. This time we're going to be talking about managing our secrets centrally. So essentially, we're talking about things like even logging into Azure, for example, or getting into a database on Azure, something like that. We want to do this in a central place. And this is where Vault comes in. This is really important when we talk about zero trust, right? So just like the auth method last week where we had to enable and configure that, secrets engines work the same. We have to enable and configure our secrets engine in order to do that, right?
Yeah.
So if we go over to my screen, I will show you what I have. I'm going to torment April again with more Terraform because that's what I do. So we have this resource here, which is essentially just enabling and configuring the Azure Secrets Engine, right? So here, what it's doing is it's we're giving it the subscription ID for our Azure subscription, giving it the tenant ID and the client ID, just the same details that we talked about on the last episode, essentially. And all that's going to do is it's going to basically use that Vault user, the new app registration that we did last week, as the thing that's going to be able to authenticate with Azure, right? So we're just configuring those things there. And obviously, we're just using the public cloud. So that's the environment that we set. So after that, we want to configure a backend role for this secrets engine. So we're just mapping it to the backend that we've just enabled and configured. We're calling the role Azure Developers. As you can see, that's a favorite of mine. And we're tuning it a little bit. We're giving it a time to live. So essentially, what this means is every time this secrets engine generates a credential, it's going to last for 300 seconds, right?
Okay.
After that, it will go to Azure and it will remove the generated credential, right? Which is super nice, right? This is how you can stop the identity sprawl.
Rotate your keys and have that policy in place.
Yeah, well, it's for me, it's better than rotating your keys because it actually destroys your keys, right?
It gets rid of them and then, sorry. Exactly. So I think a lot of our customers use that key rotation requirement, right? Or they get rid of their... They don't want store credentials sitting in other places for, you know, a year, 2 years, et cetera.
Yeah, exactly that. So that's all we're doing here is we're configuring how long we want the generated credentials to last for.
Very cool.
And we're saying it can't last more than 600 seconds, but the standard will be 300 seconds. Now, as I mentioned in the last episode, when we talk about a role in Azure, it's essentially mapping to a permission in Azure, which is what this next section of this resource is. Is we're essentially giving any generated resource the contributor role in this case, and the scope that we're giving that contributor role over is the subscription ID. So we just got a variable in here with our subscription ID. So that's super nice. Anyone that generates a credential will have contributor permissions to this subscription ID.
Cool.
And that's pretty much it. That's all it's going to take for you to get up and running with your secrets engine. So let's take this for a test drive. Let's run this Terraform. So we'll do a TF init.
And we're going to live life on the edge and apply it, aren't we?
Yep. YOLO.
Love it. Love it, Rob.
Run and apply. Let's have a quick look. And it's adding a few resources. That's cool. And we'll just enter yes. And there we go. It's all applied, right?
Awesome.
So this is super, super, super nice, right? Because now all we have to do is we'll want to log into Vault itself. So if we just clear the screen, and I'll just give a demo of how this is going to work. So essentially, we just need to set a few environment variables just to make sure we can talk to our local vault. So I'm just running vault on my my local machine.
Okay, cool.
Purposes of this, I probably would in production run this in Azure. And we'll just test out that environment variable has worked. So we'll just run a vault status and we get that back. So that's all good. So we'll just log in again. I normally wouldn't do this in production, but this is a demo. We are now logged in. So essentially, what we want to do is we want to generate a credential from Azure. So we'll just run the vault read, and everything in vault is path-based, right? So the same thing that you do in the CLI will be the same thing you do in the API, you know, even in the UI, it tends to follow the same pattern, right? So everything is path-based. So we want to read this specific path in vault, right? So the secrets engine is called Azure. We want to read some creds, and the role that we want is this Azure developer's role, right? So let's make sure I haven't got any typos, and that should, fingers crossed,
don't see any,
give me some creds. It might take a while because it's using that service principle. It's reaching out to Azure. It's going to authenticate, and then it's going to create a new app registration. It's going to give us all the permissions, give us the secrets, and it's going to feed that information back to us. So it might take a little while.
That's okay. Basically, well, we're dependent on the internet, and hopefully the internet doesn't go down tonight.
Well, in the UK. And there we go. So as you can see here, it's generated some credentials, which is fantastic. It's given us a client ID, which we're all used to seeing when we work with Azure. And it's given us a client secret. So we could use the combination of those two things to now log into Vault. So where this is nice is, let's just say you have some kind of issue that you need to troubleshoot programmatically, or maybe you need to run a script quickly and you need to give that script permissions to run something in Azure. You can generate these short-lived credentials and your script can just use these things here, right?
Awesome.
The other thing that is super, super nice about it is you don't have to worry. I mean, still, please do not commit this to your GitHub or anything like that. But if you accidentally did commit any of these credentials to GitHub or put it somewhere that you shouldn't have done, at least the impact is limited because, you know, it's only going to last for 5 minutes, as you can see here on the screen. After 5 minutes, then Vault's going to go back to Azure and say, this client ID here, let's delete it.
And
we're back to square one. So when we talk about managing secret sprawl, now we don't need to go to Azure and create a service principal every single time. And I can remember when I first started working with Azure many years ago, that was the practice, right? I'd need something.
Absolutely.
It's going to create a service principal. And then you forget about it. And then something else comes up. And then it's like, oh, I need service principal details. Right, I'll create another one. And next thing you know, you've got hundreds of service principals.
Absolutely.
It's a huge, huge risk. It's a big attack surface. So at least this way, if you need a service principal, generate it and it will clean it up for you. And that's, you know, again, when we talk about zero trust, we talk about managing your secrets centrally. This is what we're talking about. It's not just that you can go to a central place to get the secrets. It's the fact that it will do it dynamically on demand. And it takes care of the life cycle of that secret for you. So, I hope you found that useful. I hope that's going to help people with their workflows with Azure specifically. I find it super useful, personally speaking. And I hope you will too.
Absolutely. And I think that also gives us a really good use case. If let's just say you're a developer, you need to make a change in Azure, you're giving yourself that 5 minutes to make that change, time to access, kind of like a just-in-time access, and then it locks everything out and cuts that connection off. So I think that's really cool. You could do some quick deployments, some quick changes, and not have that permanent service principle in play.
Exactly. I think the other thing that's super sweet about this is that, like I say, this is completely the same as the API for Vault. So if your application needs to be Azure aware, instead of having to bake in credentials to your code, you can just use a workflow like this where your application goes to Vault, it pulls the Azure credentials and it logs in. You can have that workflow there. So it's super flexible.
Awesome. Rob, thank you again for coming back for a second episode to talk about Zero Trust Security with HashiCorp Vault. It was great to have you here, and everyone tune in next time for some more HashiCorp goodness.
My pleasure. Thank you.